Thank you, Madam Speaker. Question of the carrier.
Question of the carrier. Does the carrier yield?
Yes, Madam Speaker.
He does.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, in reviewing the testimony and committee discussion, it was asked multiple times in different ways if there was any data on this legislation and how it would impact rural communities. And the answers were always no. We don't have that data. Has there been any data surfaced to date?
Thank you for the question. And I just have to remind this body that this legislation is about innovation and trying to protect our vulnerable renters around our state. And I mean, I want to make sure I point out that the Rental Housing Association of Greater Portland and the Oregon Rental Housing Association both testified on this bill, and neither of them opposed it. So the reminder is that Senate Bill 608 is not rent controlled, and it is tied to tenancies, not units. And additionally, trusted nonpartisan economists in Oregon, including the Office of Economic Analysis, have said that they don't believe that rent regulation in Senate Bill 608 will negatively impact new supply. So we have great, you know, information that's coming with our smart bodies throughout this state and this building that are saying that we don't have any background specific, but we do not believe there's any testimony or any facts or figures that says it will not improve the quality of life for our tenants out there.
Thank you, Representative. Representative Brock-Smith, for the question.
Please, Madam Speaker.
Follow-up, does the carrier yield?
Yes, Madam Speaker.
He does? And can I just remind folks, I know we want to preface and on all, but try to make them questions and answers, both sides. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Is there any language in the bill that would protect the long-term rental market from being transitioned into short-term vacation rentals?
Thank you, Representative. Representative?
The question is this, what is this going to do to eliminate, to keep from the free market from moving their property and free use of their property into any market that they want? And this bill does not do that. This bill is actually trying to help our tenants that are in a rental situation, which is part of the emergency clause, that they have the ability to remain in those homes at a fair rent that is not rent gouging and that is very stable and predictable.
Thank you, Representative. Representative Brock-Smith, further question?
No, to the bill.
To the bill.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, I appreciate the questions and the answers of the carrier, and it's obvious that we don't have the data on how this bill is going to impact rural Oregon communities and how this legislation is going to keep our long-term rentals in place in those rural communities, especially when it comes on the coast. I have to disagree respectfully with my colleague from the Jewel of Oregon on the North Coast. As a representative from the South Coast, I am seriously concerned on how this piece of legislation will impact the short-term rental market and the long-term rental market within our communities. As I discussed on this floor last week, there's problems with legislation like this that goes statewide. Because as a former county commissioner, when you've seen one county, you've seen one county, and when you've seen one city, you've seen one city. We all have similar issues within our communities throughout the state. Housing is a problem, and I do appreciate the good representative speaking about the free market, finally, because that's what we need in this state. We need more of the free market and supply when it comes to the housing issues in this state so that we can bring down the cost of rent. I sympathize for your constituents, Madam Speaker, and all of my colleagues' constituents that have undergone the horrible, horrible impositions of the bad actors with regards to landlords. I sympathize with them. But creating statewide policy that will negatively impact my district and my good actors that could possibly cause issues with regards to a 7% increase when there's already a 3% increase a year on the taxes associated with the property, and then when you add on to the possible $15 million water bond that my community needs to fix its failing water infrastructure, now you're putting a situation where that landlord has no ability to save for the depreciation and infrastructure repair and maintenance of that property. And so I just implore you, colleagues, you know, it's never too late to send something back to committee, but I appreciate the conversation, and you know, when it comes to process, I wish we would have had a little more and with this legislation. It's just unfortunate that, to me, with all due respect to my colleagues, this bill feels like it was baked before it even hit the Senate floor. So thank you so much.